Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the third video in the STM32 FSMC series connecting the LCD in parallel mode, and today we will add the LVGL to our display. In the previous videos we have covered how to interface the display using the FSMC, and how to add the touch to the display. Today we will add the LVGL to this display, and finally use the SquareLine Studio to create an user interface, which will include the buttons and a text counter on the display. I have already covered a few videos on the LVGL, which includes how to add the library to the display, how to add the touch driver, and how to use the SquareLine Studio. Since all that has already been covered, I will not explain everything in this video. Here we have the project from the previous video, and we will continue with the same today. Let's open the project folder to copy the LVGL library. I have the LVGL folder here downloaded from their GitHub. I have downloaded the same version 8.3, which I used in the entire LVGL playlist. Let's copy the LVGL folder inside the drivers folder in the project directory. Now open the LVGL folder, and copy the LVGL configuration template next to the project folder itself. Rename the file to lvconference.h. Let's open the Cube IDE, and refresh the project. Here you can see the LVGL folder, and the configuration file has been added to the project. Now we need to add the LVGL to the path, so open the project properties, go to C, C++ build, setting, compiler, include paths. Here we will add the LVGL folder with respect to the project workspace. Now open the LVGL configuration file, and change the 0 to 1. This will enable the LVGL configuration. Here you can see the color depth is set to 16, make sure you set the right one as per the display. Now we need to add the display port template to our project, which will be used to connect the library to the display. These templates can be accessed inside the examples, porting folder. Here we will start with the LV port display template. Let's copy the content of this file, and we will paste them inside the LCD controller file we created in the previous projects. Let's enable these functions by setting it to 1. Remove this inclusion file, as we will copy the content of the header file in the LCD controller header file itself. Next we need to define the display resolution. The display resolution is 240 by 240. Let's include the SD7789H2 header file, as we would need to use some function from it. The LV port display initialization function calls the display initialization. Inside this function we will initialize our display. Then we have different strategies for the frame buffer. I have already explained them in detail in the LVGL series videos, but anyway I will give a brief description here. The single buffer strategy uses only one buffer. Since we have only one buffer, the LVGL needs to wait for the buffer to flush, before it can write the new content to the buffer. The double buffer strategy uses two buffers, where one buffer is used to flush the content to the display, while the LVGL can write the new content to the other buffer. Using two buffers requires more RAM, and since we have enough RAM here, I am going to use this double buffer strategy itself. Let me comment out the others. We need to change the display buffer to 2 here. The next function we need to change is the display flush function. Let's delete this part first. We will first calculate the height and width of the area to be modified. Now we will set the display window for the area to be modified. The X position is the start of the X coordinate, Y position is the start of the Y coordinate, width and height are already calculated. Next we can call the draw bitmap function to print the content on the display. But this function takes the entire bitmap image as the parameter, and hence I am not going to use it here. Instead, we have another function for it, draw RGB image. We can use this function to draw a part of the image. The X and Y positions are the starting point of the image, X size is width, and Y size is height. And at last we will pass the color data to it. Once the color data has been flushed, the display flush ready function is called, so that the LVGL can flash the next buffer. Alright, that is all we need to modify in the display port source file. Now let's copy the content of the display port header file, and paste them in the LCD controller header file. Make sure to modify this inclusion to lvgl.h. Let's build the code once to check for any errors. Next, we have to add the touch interface drivers to the LVGL, so copy the content of the port in-dev template file. We will add the touch interface to the LCD touch file we created in the previous tutorial. Let's delete this inclusion and fix the LVGL header file. I am only using the touch interface, so here I am removing the rest of the input devices from this file. This file is actually common for all kinds of inputs supported by the LVGL, like button, mouse, keypad, encoder, etc. You can keep them, but I don't prefer them to be here. Alright, now the LV port in-dev init function will be called from the main file, and this function only initializes the touchpad. We need to write our code to initialize the touchpad here. Let's include the ft6x06 header file, so that we can call its functions here. We will first call the ft6x06 init function, and if you remember from the last video, the device address is 70 hex. Now call the ts_start function to start the touch sensing. The LVGL will itself call the touchpad read function at a fixed interval. Inside this function, it first checks if the touchpad is pressed, and if it is, the function getXY is called to read the coordinates. The touchpad is pressed function is where the touch is detected, so here we will call our equivalent function, ts_detDetectTouch. We know that this function returns either 1 or 2 when it detects the touch, and if that happens, we will return true. Otherwise, false will be returned. Now the function touchpad_getXY is used to read the coordinates. Here we will call the equivalent function, ts_getXY, and pass the parameter of the main function. The function expects unsigned 16-bit integer, but the LV coordinates are type signed 16-bit. So let's typecast these variables before passing them to the function. That is all we need to do for the touch interface. Now copy the content of the in-dev port header file, and copy it to the LCD touch header file. Let's build the code to check for any errors. We have an issue with this if statement, so let me remove it. Alright, everything builds fine now. Now we will modify the main file. Let me delete the code from the previous tutorials first. Include the LVGL header file, along with the LCD controller and touch header files. Now in the main function, call the LVInit function to initialize the LVGL. Then call the LVPortDisplayInit to initialize the display driver, and the LVPortIndefInit to initialize the touch interface. Inside the while loop, call the LVTimerHandler every 5 milliseconds. Now open the interrupt source file, and include the LVGL header file. Inside the SysTickHandler, call the LVTickInc function, and pass the parameter 1 to it. We have configured the LVGL for our display, now we will create a user interface in the SquareLine Studio. I am using the same version 1.3.2, which I used throughout the LVGL series. Let's create a new Eclipse-based project here. Set the project folder, and give it a name. The display size is 240 by 240 pixels. The color depth is 16-bit, and I am using the LVGL version 8.3. Click Create to create the project. Let's add the text area to this screen. You can modify the text area as per your requirement. Here I am changing the text color to black, and the text font size to 20. Let's add a button to this screen. Here I am changing the background color when the button is pressed. Let's quickly test if it is working. You can see the color is changing whenever the button is pressed. Let's add a label to this button, and we will call it up. Basically, the text counter will increment whenever this button is pressed. Now add one more button, and label it down. We need to add events for these buttons, so that we can use them to increase and decrease the counter. I am calling the functions up-clicked and down-clicked when the buttons are pressed. Later we will write the code inside these functions. Open the project settings and change the LVGL include path to LVGL.h. Create a new folder where the user interface related file will be stored. Now export the UI files. Next, we will copy the UI folder we just created to the project folder. I am copying the UI folder inside the driver folder itself, just beside the LVGL directory. Now refresh the project once and you can see the UI folder in the driver directory. We need to include the UI folder to the path, so let's do it in the project settings. Include the UI header file in the main file. After the LVGL has been initialized, call the UI init to initialize the UI. Let's build it once to check for errors. We do have an error, and that is in the UI screen file. It says that the font size 20 is undefined. Actually, I have set the font size 20 in the UI, but it has not been enabled in the LVGL configuration file. Let's open the configuration file. Here are the fonts defined. Set the font 20 to 1. Let's build it again. We don't have any errors now, so let's flash it to the board. There was a little issue with the display, and it was because the width and height were not calculated properly. We needed to add a 1 here. Let's flash it again to the board. Here you can see the UI has been loaded to the display. But when I try to tap on the buttons, they don't register the touches. Instead, the touches are being registered when I am pressing some other part of the screen. Actually, the screen is flipped 90 degrees, but the touch controller is using the original orientation. That is why the buttons are being assumed at the bottom of the screen. To fix this, we need to modify the touch readings being fed to the LVGL. Inside the touchpad getXY function, after reading the touch coordinates, we will first store them in other variables. Now update the X and Y coordinates using each other's values. Basically, we are shifting the touch coordinates data 90 degrees to the left. Now we will write the UI event functions. Let's include the main header file and the standard IO header file. Define the integer variable num to keep track of the counter, and the array num char, which will be used to store the num value in the character format. Now, when the up button is pressed, the up clicked function will be called. Here we will increment the variable num. Then sprintf is used to convert the variable's value to the character format. Now we need to print this array to the text area. We can use the function lvTextAreaSetText to do this. Now clear the data stored in the num char, so that there is no residue in the array. We do the same when the downclicked function is called. Instead of incrementing the variable, here we will decrease it. Alright, our final code is ready, so let's build and flash it to the board. You can see the touches are now getting registered at the correct location. Pressing the up button increases the counter. And the down button is decreasing the counter value. Since we have defined the num variable as an integer, it can go negative also. So everything is working fine with our display, which is connected via the FSMC. You can try other LVGL videos also, and try to make a better UI. This is it for the video. I hope everything was clear. You can download the code from the link in the description. Keep watching and have a nice day ahead.